I believe and I receive. Thank you, Lord. By your stripes, I was healed. Thank you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And lift up your hands and say, Father, thank you for your word, for the wind of your spirit. We're paying attention. We're taking the time to turn to you and see. Thank you for manifestation of your glory. Have your way, Father. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 It reminds me, you know, sometimes you're doing simple things. You go to work, you come to church, you're having an ordinary day. And then there's just something that suddenly happened that's just not like the norm. It's not like regular. It's something that the Holy Spirit does to cause us to take the time to pay attention, to just stop, to turn, to see what's happening. I'm concerned that we may be too busy at time to have the time to turn to see. Maybe that we might not even know that the Lord might be up to something. When we were in worship and I felt the wind, a mighty wind, and I had to turn to see what he was doing so that we could flow with him at that moment, because you have to go with the wind of the Spirit. How many have had encounters of the Holy Ghost kind that you had to turn to see? That God messed up your regular day. He just showed up at an unexpected time and did something that you didn't expect, that he blessed you through unexpected vessels, that he moved that you didn't even know he was going to move, that he just got a way to just get you to take the time to turn to see. See, when God is bringing forth a momentum in your life that he wants you to draw nigh unto him more, he knows how to get your attention, and he knows how to do something that will cause you to turn to pay attention to him. My God, I'm thinking of Moses. You know, Moses, he spent 40 years in a strange land, and he was hidden, and then, you know the story, he ended up with favor growing up in Pharaoh's house for another 40 years, but who he was couldn't be hidden any longer, and he started having just a heart for his people, and he didn't have any training, nothing, and he just moved in the flesh and committed murder, and just... So then he had to go on the backside of the mountains of the desert for another 40 years until he was 120 years old. And I think I'm 60, so I think I'm halfway there. And he was on the backside of the desert. Because sometimes what gets you to go in a hiding place is because you did something in your flesh. Or some other people did something to your flesh. Or the flesh couldn't be taking under subjection. Something happened. That something gets you to just say, okay, I'm not even going to try that anymore. I'm not even going to try that. I'm just going to go over here and I'm going to tend to the sheep and I'm going to do whatever I'm supposed to do. I'm just going to work at the post office. It's a good word because sometimes people, they stop doing the ordinary. Like somehow, you know, if they stop working at the post office, it's going to get people, it's going to get God to move faster. But God is not waiting for you to stop working at the post office. God knows where you are, what you're doing. God knows even where the post office is. Go figure. God knew where Moses was, and Moses was faithful in what he was doing. David was faithful in taking care of the sheep. Elisha was faithful. Paul was faithful. Jesus was still being a carpenter. Right? I remember when I answered the call, I was doing accounting. And I kept doing it for a good 10 years. I remember getting off work at 5 o'clock and running, rushing home, jumping in the shower, getting in the car, loading the car with a little speaker and the cassette tape recorder and plug in and beat the traffic and say, Jesus! I didn't have time to study the word for 5 hours. I didn't have time to get on my knees all day. Just like Smith Wigglesworth was a plumber. He would rush home, wash his hand, and go lay hands on the sick that they may recover. Hallelujah. But see, God has a way to know where you are, what you're doing. And I believe that in this season, if you've had spiritual encounters before, you are going to get some like you never had before. I believe that wherever you are, whatever you're doing, the Holy Spirit is going to have a way to just move in the unusual, something extraordinary happening in the midst of your day that will cause you to turn around. Yes, Lord, let me read this story. Oh, Moses. Moses means drawing out. Moses means drawing out. And Moses felt really bad, I'm sure, because he had moved in the flesh years before, and I don't think he had a clue. I don't think he had a clue that something was going to happen that day. You know what I love the most in what I do is to watch God touch people that are not expecting it. Do something a different way in their lives. Move through ways that people have no idea that God can move that way. And I'm not talking about huge things, because sometimes we miss the greater because we don't turn to pay attention in the ordinary thing. That it's like having a trail of something that happened like this morning and taking the time to just stop, turn to the side and trying to ask, well, what is it you're doing right now? I feel there's a shift, there's something. I remember working sometimes and just feel something and just through some, the lawyers could just say one word, you know, and I would hear something and I would have to hurry up and just make a note of it. To take the time in my spirit to be able. Yeah, exactly right. I totally agree. Hallelujah. Just like God, she'll do something so that people would pay attention to her. We are a society who multitask. we're a society that's so multitasked, and I've seen people watch TV, be on the laptop, be on the phone, have another earplug for the music. Yes, at the same time, it's too much. I said it's too much. How can you stop and pay attention? There is some incredible value in being able to take your time. Even if somebody watch a movie, if you all over the place, if you're looking at your phone or your computer or something else, how can you see the look in their eyes when they speak? How can you see what the voices do not say? There's something about spending time with one another. And I know you did that for Thanksgiving, just talking to each other, looking into each other's eyes. But maybe some of you had Thanksgiving where nobody talked to each other, because everybody was, all right, going back to Moses. Amen. We have to stop and smell the roses. The roses are there. But in chapter 3, familiar story, it says in verse 1, now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law. Exodus chapter 3, verse 1, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the back of the desert and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire from the midst of the bush. So he looked, and behold, the bush was burning with fire, but the bush was not consumed. Then Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush does not burn. So when the Lord saw that he turned aside to look, sometimes we want a word from the Lord, but we don't take the time. We draw nigh unto God, and he draw nigh unto us. There's something about you people in this generation that in the midst of everything that's happening in the world are looking to see what God is up to. There's something about turning aside, not to this or to that, but to the Lord. Because we, children of God, we, when we have turned to the Lord, the veil was taken away. The veil that was in the old that would hinder people to see, to hear, to have a personal relationship with their Lord, according to 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16, or wherever it's highlighted, all the way to verse 18, glory to God, hallelujah. But when one turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Now, the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. And now, beholding Herem, as in a mirror, the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, even by the Spirit of the Lord. I can go to a whole lot of things in this passage, but can I tell you that oh God, when the Lord sees us turn away, you see, I've been in times in my life that I've spend so much time trying to analyze what was happening. See, when God, when there's a burning bush experience, you could also miss receiving the impact of what God has, because you're sitting there trying to reason with it, trying to analyze it. Now, what kind of bush is it? What kind of wood is it? Which way is the wind going? And what exactly is going on here? Where is that in the Bible? Where are these other people doing? Well, I've never seen that before. Where can somebody do that? Where can this happen? When there's a burning bush experience, you cannot take your time and stop to look at it, to reason with it. You have to turn to the Lord. You have to turn to Him in submission, to be open to whatever He has to say, whatever He has for you to do, whatever He wants to speak to you. My God, there's also times that instead of analyzing the situation, we want to put a big shrine of it, and we're not able to receive new things because we still stuck on a past, burning bush experience. And if the Holy Spirit is moving today, but not like we experienced Him to move 7-10 years ago, we might miss what He's doing today, now. We're not waiting for the Holy Spirit to come. Pentecost came. Holy Spirit is here. Now I know when the restrainer is taken away, which is really the church, when the church is taking up, the Holy Spirit in the church will not be here. But make no mistake, the Holy Spirit is omnipresent. Hear this. There is no other way to be born again but by the Spirit of the Lord. Oh, glory. Since we're in the neighborhood, I thought I mentioned it. Hallelujah. Had somebody tell me, well, you know, the Holy Spirit's going to be gone. I said, no, the church is going to be gone. No, we're not going to have a new way to be saved. All right, I go back to Moses. Holy Spirit, move the veil. Did I finish? No, I didn't. I just had to stop. But when the Lord saw that, He turned aside. See, we can't. We need to take the time to pay attention. We need to not reason with our burning bush experience. And we cannot build a shrine like Peter tried to do on the Mount of Transfiguration. We can't box God and start having a nice way that we decided how God should move. And because He moved this way, because we did A and B, then surely now we can start a church called the A and B Church. You do it our way, then God will do that. And of course, you can go into the whole thing that, yes, the bush, my God, the thorn, you can look at it representing our sin. You can see, oh God, the whole work of salvation and the grace and the mercy. That once you're born again, you are a burning bush filled with the fire of the living God, filled with an incredible, God must say, you are born of the Spirit, filled with the Spirit. You're the burning bush that some people in this hour is going to turn aside to see what is God up to in her life. How come He's still standing? How come she's still standing? It's time for us to be filled, to receive a baptism of fire. Fire that doesn't destroy. God is a consuming fire. Tongues of fire. Whoop! Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Fire, fire, fire. Refining fire. The fire that brings a holiness. The fire that brings an empowerment to keep going in the midst of warfare. To keep going in the midst of hurt, of pain, of sickness. To keep going in the midst of the world. A fire that no matter what tries to come to consume us, we will not be consumed by the world. We will not be consumed by the things of the enemy. Because we are being filled by a consuming fire that doesn't stop burning, burning, burning. I believe we're going to be hotter than we've ever been. Woo! Can't wait. And then, I don't know, sometimes we wait for what's to come, but the Lord, he's saying here, so the Lord saw that he turned aside to look. I just had to say it again. The most ordinary thing. Have you ever been in a service like today or listening to a message at the same time that you were doing your computer, your TV, your phone, and spending time with your mate? And you heard the message and you thought, oh, this is for so-and-so. Or you thought, oh, I already know that scripture. Oh, I know the story of Moses. I know the story of Moses. Actually, the bushes is this and this is that. And in Deuteronomy, it says this and that. Sometimes we can miss what God is telling us by being so consumed by everything around us. By other people. It's a great battle of the mind when you battle being consumed with a situation. Consumed with an argument or a situation or something that pertains to your love. I'm talking about being consumed. You think about it. You dwell on it. You can't get it off your mind. Everything that you go through takes you back to that very thing. It consumes the way you eat, the way you talk, the way you walk. It consumes. You cannot even go over here because you are consumed with that situation. It takes every waking day that you have. And the more you stop trying to be consumed by it, the greater it becomes. And you find yourself not able to have peace because you are consumed. Well, that's the way that we need to be with God Almighty. We need to be consumed with everything that pertains to him. We need to be so consumed by the things of the kingdom that everything, every time something dark happens in the world, my God, every time it happens, we can shake it off and we can just move forth and let the glory of the Lord be seen, because we are moving into transforming glory. I see what the Lord is doing in our lives. I'm amazed. And God called to him from the midst of the bush. And he said, Moses, Moses. God, I remember giving a whole series on the calling of God. Moses, Moses. Woo! Sam. Oh, my God. Oh, let's not go there. Let's not go there. He said, here, here, here I am. I'm not over here. I'm not over there. I'm not consumed by this. I'm not consumed by that. I am here, right now, believing that now faith is. I believe what you did yesterday. I believe that you have more tomorrow. But my God, there is nothing like now. There is nothing like today. And I'm turning to the side right now. Because my God, your presence is always with us. You never leave me, never forsake me. You are here right now and you are doing. Here I am, my God. Here I am, my God. Woo! God. And he said, Do not draw near this place. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place where you stand is holy ground. Moreover, he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. And the Lord said, I have surely seen, he heard the oppression of my people who are in Egypt, and I have heard their cry, my God, God hears us because of their taskmaster, for I know their sorrows. I know their sorrows. And of course, you continue the story, and God said, tell them I am, that I am. And there's this thing that happens when you have a burning bush experience. Is that when the Spirit of the Lord comes upon you, and when you in a situation that truly you should be consumed, truly you should have died, truly that sickness should have taken you already, truly that situation in your home should have completely destroyed everything. There is no way. People around you in your family, they look at you wondering, how is that flame still burning? How is that person still being a minister of fire with everything that she has gone through, that he has gone through? How is it that when the enemy came in like a flood, they started believing more? How is it that it didn't consume them? There is something in them that the enemy cannot take away. There is something in them that the enemy cannot destroy. There is something in there that cannot be destroyed. They are a burning bush that will never cease to burn, because the consuming fire of God is going to burn and burn and burn everything that's in the way, to make you a flame of fire, a minister of fire, to burn for such a time as this. My God, 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 he's just so amazing, because not only he said Moses, Moses, but when he wants to call you to do something, you know, to do something in the midst of your ordinary day. It could be just to say something to somebody. It could be to pray for somebody. It could be to pray for somebody that's not even in the same room. It could be the Spirit of the Lord just you reading your Bible. And since we're talking about the Bible, it's a little bit the same way when you're reading the Bible. Don't study it so much. Study it as the Holy Spirit leads you, but don't study it so much that you start analyzing the Bible instead of the Bible analyzing you. Don't try to study it so much that you might miss to turn aside to just read it. So that the Holy Spirit can read it to you. Don't spend time the same way that we see that you can be consumed by what other people are doing, and this is for them. No, don't be consumed by what other commentaries are saying. I remember one day seeing in the commentary a Greek meaning for a word, and then the Hebrew meaning for the name of a person. And I ministered on that, and then I went home, and the Holy Spirit said, are you sure that's what it means? Was spiritual spanking 5,920. And I discovered there's many kind of different translation, even of the Hebrew, of the Greek. You have to be careful. You have to be careful. I remember when he said, no, just read, let me teach you. Right. That the commentaries become specific things that the Holy Spirit leads you to. Hallelujah. Because you want to be able to just turn to see so you can hear. So he can tell you something that he has for you. Otherwise, you would limit yourself by what somebody else. Right. Hallelujah. But when Moses turned to see, and when he was called out of the burning bush, it was such a beautiful way for God to remind Moses My son, I've forgiven you. You've been hiding over here for 40 days. 40 years, I'm sorry. One day, 1,000 years. Yep. Said you've been hiding here, but look, look, look. I am your God, I am with you, and I am calling you out. Paul was on his way, on his big horse. To kill, steal, and destroy people on the way. He was looking for somebody to kill. When God knocked him off his horse, gave him a burning bush experience, caused him to turn to the Lord, and caused him to say, Lord, what do you want me to do? Isaiah was, Lord, what do you want me to do? Here I am. What do you want me to do? When God takes you deeper into things, it's for you. It's just for you. It could be for simple things. We cannot look for God just in the big happenings. Because he's here now, today. Right here. This morning he moved. And sometimes I see the Lord move, you know, meet so great. We have healing, deliverance. And I also know that sometimes, especially when we go to splash meetings outside and people are not used to the move of the Spirit, like you guys are here, that there's some people that they, instead of, oh, God is moving. Let me turn to see. Let me turn to receive it. Let me turn. No. Well, I don't believe people can fall under the power. Well, let them fall. I don't believe in that. When people say that, I said, oh, it never happened to you? In this season, let's not get stuck on things that we don't understand. It's a beautiful thing to be in awe of God. God is awesome. It's a beautiful thing to expect God in ordinary time. When you go to work, you never know. I used to go to work and always have my desk ready like it was the last time. I did that for 10 years. Because I was expecting. I wasn't there because I didn't have any faith. I was there because I did have faith. And everyone that I would meet that needed to know the Lord, I would talk about the Lord. I was on fire for the Lord right there and then. Because if you are a burning bush right where you are, you will be placed near to other people that will get on fire just because you're on fire. You will be right there in the midst of whatever situation you are, with the peace, with the love, with the strength of the Lord, with the fire of God all over you. And don't you think that fire spreads? You will bring warmth to the ones. They will be on fire. Actually, there's some people when you go to work, you want them to leave you alone. They can't leave you alone. They knock at your door and they always, why? Because you're on fire, they're cold. You always say something profound, something filled with wisdom. They're looking for you. They're looking for you. Moses, Moses. Samuel, Samuel. Saul, Saul. When Saul was knocked off his horse, twice his name was called. Saul, Saul, Simon, of course, Simon had to be in the list. Simon, Simon, Martha, Martha, Jerusalem, Jerusalem. Today the Lord is asking you, telling you, take the time to you, to me. Let's be so mindful to his presence. Let's so expect a mighty God, an awesome God, to do great and mighty things as he takes us from glory to glory. As you are becoming mighty glory carrier. That whatever comes your way, you will be able to just know that it cannot destroy you. You indestructible. You are invisible. You are more than a conqueror. You are strong and mighty in the Lord. And you are that all by yourself. But oh, glory, hallelujah, I see the Lord taking all of us one log next to another log to become a whole burning bush for such a time as this, the body of Christ to be a burning bush that everybody will turn aside to see what is that, what is going on, why are these people still worshiping God? Why are these people not walking away? Why are these people more on fire and their breakthrough didn't come yet? Why are they still loving God and what they've been waiting for didn't come to pass yet? Who are these people? We are the children of God, the bride of Christ. We are, hallelujah, the church. We are, hallelujah, we are. Say, I hear I am, Lord.
Here I am, Lord.
Speak to me.
Speak to me.
I will pay attention.
I will hear.
I will obey.
I
delight in turning aside. The veil is being removed.
I can see.
I am born again. I thank you because I believe that nothing can destroy me. I have the abundant life for eternity. I sing praises to your name. You are the great I am. Right now. Right now I believe. You are Savior, Healer, Deliverer. And I rejoice. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name.